and just bring them on and we'll talk to them. That's it every day. So I've had to switch over.
Okay, everybody. We're just waiting for one or two more folk to kick off. We've got an awful lot of ground to cover today from Gordon, so we'll make a quick start just in a wee minute.
I like your background, Alan. How did you do that? Is that with a green screen?
Yes, it saves me tidy up my room. I just bought one of these pull-up green screens, and once you've got that, you just go on to Zoom, and you can basically create your own background.
See, I have got that, and then I was on a call with somebody yesterday, and they did it with a PowerPoint. So they had their whole, they didn't. I don't think they had a green screen as well. They made a PowerPoint, saved it as a JPEG or something, and then they changed their background. And that way I can't get to do that. I don't know why.
I think you could either have a standard, a sort of set background, or you can actually put on video clips and so on as well if you want.
You have to have a green screen, do you?
Yeah, they're not very expensive. You can pick them up on Amazon for not very much. Mine just comes as a, it's like these pull-up screens that the chamber have that say, Renfrew Chamber of Commerce. Just a slightly wider version than that. Because you see, if I do that, you can see the edge of the screen there.
Right, okay.
Mine's only just wide enough to, I think my one's 48 inches wide, which is just wide enough for me to hide the mess behind the screen.
Right, your head doesn't disappear when you go like that, like some of these virtual backgrounds, does it? Do you know when you
No.
notice people's heads disappear? Anyway,
It
sorry.
works well on Zoom. It doesn't work on GoToMeeting or some of the other ones, unfortunately.
All right,
So.
okay. Thank
Okay,
you.
everybody. Welcome to you all. Thank you very much for joining us on day four when we're covering our first session on LinkedIn with Gordon White. I'm not going to say a great deal about Gordon, other than Gordon's been running businesses for about the last 34 years in a huge variety of sectors. I know what you're thinking. He did start when he was 10 years old, but he's
Wish.
very much at the cutting edge of digital media and how that's developed. And for any of you that may have come across his new media breakfasts, that really has been a fantastic series for a number of years. And I know Gordon has certainly feel that it's kept him fresh and very much at the cutting edge of new developments. So we're delighted that we're able to tap into his knowledge and his expertise today. So without further ado, I'll pass over to Gordon from FatBus. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob, and thanks for the opportunity to talk to you, and thank you all for coming along. I take it you can all see that screen okay? Yeah. I'll say right at the start, this is about as Christmassy as I ever get. And I'm hoping my wife doesn't walk in on this presentation because next thing she'll be expecting a Christmas present. I just want to say I'll share this presentation with you, or I'll send the link to Bob and he can share it with you. But I'll just give you a little heads up about the actual presentation itself. It's slightly different from a PowerPoint presentation. It's created in a thing called Prezi Next, and it's what they call a conversational presentation. So once you get the link to it, you don't need to start at slide one to go and go through to the bit you want to refresh your memory on. You can actually just click on the topic and it will bring it up. And then if you just hover at the side, at the right-hand side to the little house, it'll take you back to the main screen, and then you can go to the next section you want to cover. So just a little bit of housekeeping on how to operate the presentation when you get it. I'm quite happy to be interrupted during the session if there's anything you don't understand. We'll hopefully have time for question and answers at the end, but by all means, just shout out or stick something in the chat. I think Bob's going to keep an eye on the chat and he can ask any questions as we go. I'm quite happy to be interrupted along the way. This is actually an extract from a three-hour LinkedIn training session that I do. So I'm doing part of it today and part of it a week today. This session focuses more on what you need to do for your own personal profile. And the next section actually focuses on what you can do for your business and your business presence on LinkedIn. And as I say, they are extracts from much more detailed training sessions that we run on Zoom. Without any further ado, I'll start. The first thing we're going to look at is the LinkedIn interface itself and some of the things that you should understand about the interface. And it gives you a much clearer picture of just how powerful it is and why it's becoming such an important tool nowadays. So the first thing that I want to cover is the fact that it's still very much a growing platform. You'll see here figures from 2018, 2019, 2020. And the only figures I have for 2020 at the moment are the number of worldwide users has increased again significantly in 2020. And the daily active users have increased by up to 50% of the users are daily active users now. If we had gone back to 2017, this figure of 40% would have been actually under 20%. And there's been a significant jump in the number of daily active users. And there are a couple of reasons for that that I'll come back to as to why there are more people using it on a daily basis. And you can see at the bottom here, Microsoft's latest quarterly report shows a 31% increase in user sessions in the last quarter, largely down to COVID and people resorting to or having more time to be on LinkedIn, but also because of the lack of physical networking, more people resorting to LinkedIn to do their networking. 16% increase in marketing solutions revenue, that's LinkedIn advertising. A 27% increase in consumer subscribers to Microsoft 365, and I'll come back to why that's important as well. And the number of people using LinkedIn Learning has doubled in the last year, so it's now over 1 million hours a week of LinkedIn learning, or LinkedIn video training that's actually being consumed. So you can see that it's still very much a growing platform. The other thing to appreciate is it's different from all our social media channels. Today we're talking about the middle one there, LinkedIn.com. There are three platforms in LinkedIn. There's LinkedIn Sales Navigator, LinkedIn Talent Solutions, which is the recruiter platform, and then LinkedIn.com, which is the one that you and I use. Now, within LinkedIn.com, we have premium accounts, and there is a couple of things I'm going to discuss today that you would be better to have a premium account for, and when I do discuss them, I'll tell you that this is an area that you would be better to have a premium account. But other than that, all the things I'm going to show you today, you can do on a free account. And also within LinkedIn, you have LinkedIn ads. And the reason I mention this is that all other platforms, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, are pretty much 100% reliant on ad revenue. And ad revenue then determines what you see in the newsfeed. And they take control of what you see. Whereas LinkedIn are not dependent on ad revenue, so you can still get reasonable organic reach on LinkedIn. And just to give you an idea of the split, now it may have changed in the last quarter because of the increase in ad revenue, but the last figures I've got show that 17% of the revenue comes from Sales Navigator. 65% of their income comes from their recruiter platform, and 18% comes from LinkedIn.com, and that's made up of premium account subscriptions and LinkedIn ads. But the figures may have changed slightly because of the jump in the ad revenue, but it gives you an idea of why LinkedIn is different from other channels, that it's not 100% reliant on ad revenue. It's much more than a networking tool, and it's important to understand the real power of it. Contrary to popular belief, it's more than just a Rolodex. And I did actually do a guest lecture at Strathclyde University to a group of students, and I put this picture up, and one of the girls at the front asked, put her hand up and asked me what a Rolodex was, which made me feel very old. But there is still quite a common belief that it's a place that you have contacts and you sort of occasionally dip in and out and see who's connected to you and all the rest of it. But it's much, much more than that. It's widely accepted as the biggest business networking site, but it's also one of the biggest business content publishing platforms. And back in 2016, when LinkedIn was bought by Microsoft, there was a strong rumor at that time that Financial Times were actually going to buy LinkedIn because of its publishing power. But that didn't happen, and Microsoft bought it. I would imagine much for the same reasons, actually. It's also one of the biggest learning platforms. If you have a premium account, you get free access to LinkedIn Learning, which was originally lynda.com, which was a paid learning platform. So the quality of the courses that you get on LinkedIn Learning is actually very, very good. And there are literally thousands of training courses on just about any topic you can mention. So it's one of the benefits of having a paid account. It's also becoming one of the biggest and best business advertising platforms. Not so long ago, maybe 18 months ago, LinkedIn advertising was quite prohibitive in terms of small businesses. It was an expensive option, and unless your conversion, the value of a conversion of a sale was quite high, then LinkedIn wasn't worthwhile. That's no longer the case. LinkedIn is very accessible to just about any business now in terms of advertising costs. And in the session next Thursday, we'll look a bit more closely at how you can use LinkedIn advertising. It works extremely well and is an extremely good option nowadays. So these are some of the things that you should appreciate about LinkedIn. It's also very much at the moment about people. So it's a person-to-person platform, but I think that is changing, and the LinkedIn are investing a lot at the moment in things like business pages, and they're putting a lot of effort into making pages more engaging, and that's something that we will cover next week as well. And it's important to appreciate the shift towards LinkedIn pages. But at the moment, most of the successes we see on LinkedIn come through what happens on your personal profile. So that makes the strength of your profile critical to the success you're going to have on LinkedIn. And a strong personal profile will attract relevant connections to you. It's not about lots of connections, it's about relevant connections. It will help you project your expertise. It will build trust in you, the business, and your products and services. It will encourage genuine inquiries that are relevant to you. It will help you identify opportunities. In short, it will make you findable, knowable, and shareable, which is what we're trying to achieve with the time that you spend on LinkedIn. Success is driven by what LinkedIn knows about you. And the more that you tell LinkedIn, the more it will actually help you, the more the algorithm will actually help you. And the algorithm learns from every single thing you do on LinkedIn. Every action you take, the algorithm learns something more about you. So the information that you share on your profile page is critical to the success you have on LinkedIn, because you're telling the algorithm about you and the types of things you're into and the types of people that would be relevant for you to connect with. It learns from who you connect with and who you follow. It learns about what content you engage with, so what you like, comment, and share, It will learn every time you do that. It will learn something new. What content you post, right down to which words, what words you use in the posts that you share. It will learn from the influencers you follow, the pages you follow, and the groups you join. So every single action that you take on LinkedIn is helping the algorithm to understand a bit more about you and what is relevant to you. And it's important to understand that. And the more active you are on LinkedIn, the more the algorithm is able to help you achieve success on LinkedIn. It's also getting better and better. And the reason that the daily active users has grown so much, there's a couple of reasons. Improvements to the interface. So in 2016, when Microsoft bought LinkedIn, there were lots of different platforms. There was the mobile platform, the desktop platform, even Groups was a separate app on mobile, for example. So the new interface that was brought in around 2018 streamlined all of that. So your experience on mobile and desktop is pretty seamless now. It's much more intuitive to use. So that helped encourage a lot more people to actually use LinkedIn on a more regular basis. COVID-19 has massively increased the usage as well. So in the quarter before last, there was an increase of, I think it was 37% of sessions, and then 27% increase in the last quarter, 31% increase again in the most previous quarter, the most recent quarter. So COVID has actually driven a lot of people onto LinkedIn, as I say, probably looking for other networking opportunities. And then what has driven a lot of the change are the Microsoft integrations that have been introduced gradually and are still being rolled out to users, and particularly Office 365 integrations. I'm going to show you a quick video now. It's about 4 minutes long, but it's a video from Microsoft which explains much more eloquently than I can about some of the integrations. The one thing I would say is if you're using Office 365, there is a setting in the back end that you need to activate to enable LinkedIn integrations. So if you're not getting some of these, it could be because they haven't been rolled out to you yet, because they have a strange way of rolling things out. Or it could be that you haven't activated the back end. There's a check button in the back end to allow Microsoft integrations. I've got some of these available to me now, but as I say, they are being rolled out at the moment. So I'll just run the video and let you see some of the things that are coming.
Office 365 gives you the flexibility and choice in how you share, communicate, and connect. With new LinkedIn integrations, Office 365 brings you rich insights and intelligent services that harness the power of your professional network. The first area where this becomes real is with the new Office 365 profile card. Recently, we introduced a redesigned profile card that allows you to see rich insights about the people that you're working with from across your organization. The new org chart shows a complete view of a person's position in the company, including their direct reports and co-workers. You can also see a history of your conversations and files that you're collaborating on. But with a lot of email conversations taking place outside your organization, we wanted to make it easier for you to understand who you're working with and ultimately build stronger relationships. With the new LinkedIn integration, every time I come across an external contact, I can hover over their name and click View Profile. Office 365 uses the LinkedIn graph to help source the right person. If there's more than one match, our intelligent services will present a short list of likely contacts. The information presented here respects the privacy preferences of the LinkedIn user. In this case, I'm not connected with Jim on LinkedIn yet, but I can see the profile information that he has chosen to share publicly, including a profile picture, mutual connections, and work experience. Plus, I can quickly add this contact to my network. I also continue to have access to the full power of the profile card's files and conversation history. We're beginning to roll out this new experience in the browser, and it's coming soon across our Microsoft services. So let me explain what makes this possible. Behind the scenes, we establish a connection between your LinkedIn account and your Azure Active Directory, the central identity management system for Office 365. Every time you look up a person, we dynamically pull their information from LinkedIn and display it within the profile card to make sure that you're always looking at the most up-to-date information. As a user, your data remains yours and your LinkedIn privacy settings are respected. You're always in control of who you connect with and you can unlink your account at any time. If you're an admin, you're also in control of connected features in your tenant and you can turn this capability off or on at any time. Beyond the new profile card, we wanted to leverage the intelligence of LinkedIn to help improve other common scenarios. We know that around 80% of resumes worldwide are created in Microsoft Word. So we wanted to set out to make finding your next job easier with a new feature called Resume Assistant. Now, as I'm preparing my resume, Word can provide recommendations for sought-after experiences and skills that I should amplify based on aggregate role and industry data from across LinkedIn. In this case, Word has automatically detected that I'm creating a resume, but you can also access Resume Assistant from the Review tab. Word has automatically scanned my resume to identify the roles that I have experience in and connected with LinkedIn to find the highest performing examples of work experiences written by similar people for similar roles. You can scroll through them to get an inspiration for writing your own, and you can also update the industry at any time to narrow your results. Resume Assistant also helps you to see the top skills that other people with your desired role tend to highlight on their LinkedIn profile. Including these in your resume can help you stand out to recruiters. You'll also find articles to help you write your resume and stay ahead of other candidates. To help you further, you can also see open job opportunities that are updated in real time, thanks to the power of LinkedIn, and further tailor your resume based on the skills that the employers are currently advertising for. Finally, within Resume Assistant, you can privately let recruiters know that you're open to new opportunities and keep moving closer to landing your dream job. Behind the scenes, Word applies cognitive services to determine your line of work and can search LinkedIn's professional network to find key skills and terms from across your industry, then present that for you in a digestible format. We're also making it easier to improve your office skill set by bringing access to helpful videos from LinkedIn right into the Office apps. For example, here I am in Excel, and I'm interested in creating a pivot table. If I don't have any experience in doing this, I can type pivot table into the Tell Me bar, go to help, and now I can see rich content that guides me through the process of building a pivot table. I can follow along with the instructions in the video without ever having to leave Excel, making it easier than ever to master complex tasks throughout Office 365. These capabilities will be rolling out soon, and we're continuing to find innovative new ways to help you be more productive. And together with LinkedIn, we're working on a number of exciting new features for Office 365. Look out for more news in the coming months. Thanks for watching.
So you can see why there are more users, because there are actually many more touch points now, and Office 365 is becoming this sort of de facto email platform nowadays, and pulling the content from LinkedIn into Office 365 is encouraging a lot more daily active users. The final thing I want to cover here is advanced search, because a lot of people thought when the new interface came in that advanced search had disappeared, but in fact it hasn't, and it's probably more powerful than ever. And I want to start with just a little story about how I use advanced search. A couple of years ago, I was invited up to Aberdeen to speak to a group of charities about online marketing. And because it was going to be in January, I decided to train. And it meant I was going to have a couple of hours to kill in Aberdeen before I came back on the train. And I thought, oh, let's see if I can arrange a meeting in Aberdeen with somebody that I can potentially work with. And what I did was use advanced search to identify possible people that I could work with in Aberdeen. And because it was going to be in the city centre, because I wasn't going to have a car, I thought, well, it's going to be an office. We don't work with any accountants or lawyers in Aberdeen, so let's see if we can get a meeting with an accountant or a lawyer in Aberdeen. So I'll show you what we actually did, what I did to actually try and do this. So I'm on your homepage on LinkedIn. If you just click on the search bar, click return, you'll get a page like this comes up. And at the moment, I'm not actually searching for anything in particular. I've just hit the return bar and search, and it's brought this, the main search page up. And then you can see some tabs along the top here. You can search for people, jobs, content, companies, etc. So I want to search for people. So I've clicked on people, and you can see here it brings up, now I don't know why it hasn't on this screenshot, but normally it would have brought up a figure at the top here of 3 million and something, which is my LinkedIn network. And if you see the term your LinkedIn network, what that actually means is your first level connections, your second level connections, and your third level connections. So the people you're connected to, people that are connected to them, and the people that are connected to them are what LinkedIn terms your network. So at the moment, I've only specified that I want to search people. I haven't actually told it what kind of person I want to search and I want to a filter for. So if we start to apply some filters here along the top, you can filter by company or by group or what school they went to, events. The one that I want to focus on is the all filters, the one at the end here. So if we click into that, it brings up a sidebar like this. Now, because there's no point in me searching first level connections because I can actually just contact them in LinkedIn. So what I've done is decided to search for second and third level connections. I've chosen location as Aberdeen. And then scrolling down a bit, you've got other options like if you know the current company they work for or the past company they work for, and I didn't in that case. So scrolling further down, I've put in industry, I've put legal service or accounting. And scrolling further down, you've got other options like profile language, open to pro bono consulting or volunteering, service providers. So you can actually just, if you scroll down, if you can't find the job, you can just type in legal and it'll bring, or just start typing the word and it'll bring in the different types of service providers. So I've applied the filters for second and third level connections, Aberdeen, working in law and accountancy. And when I filter that, it brings it down. You can see over on the left-hand side here, I've got 2,100 results. Now, that is far too many people for me to start scrolling through. So I want to apply some further filters to that. So going back to the top search bar here, I've typed in title colon managing director, and then in capitals OR managing partner, and then in capitals again OR founder, and it then filters for anybody in legal or accounting that is a managing partner, a managing director, or a founder of the business, because these are decision makers and these are the people that I want to try and meet. And you can see that it has brought it down to 171 results. So that's a far more manageable number to actually search through. So that's basically how advanced search works. I'm going to come back to how I used that information a bit later on, but it was just to demonstrate how you can actually filter out and search for specific types of people. When you get the slide presentation, I would encourage you to read, this is LinkedIn's page about advanced search, and I would encourage you to read that because there are a number of other options that I haven't got time to cover today. But when you get the presentation, please have a read at that, and it will give you a bit more explanation to advanced search.
Gordon, can I just jump in there very quickly?
Yeah.
That's really interesting functionality. How would you summarise that compares to, for example, the kind of paid search or the kind of premium kind of search function that you're perhaps having to pay for?
I should have said at the start of that little demonstration of advanced search that you're better to have the premium account to do that, because you're going to get minimum search results on the free account. I think you only get five results, somewhere like that. I should have said that if you are going to use advanced search, then you're better to have a premium account. If you don't know whether you're going to use it, they're always running 30-day free trials. And I would advise you to take the free trial, see if you're going to make use of it, and then commit to it after that. But you're going to get a lot more search results with the premium account than you are with the free account. Yeah. Okay, so I mentioned at the start that your personal profile is critical to success on LinkedIn. So what I want to do now is run through some of the things you need to do to optimize your personal profile on LinkedIn. And to do this, I'm going to actually just feature my own profile. One of the other things that you may have noticed is that this is the brand new design for LinkedIn. So if some of you, for example, have seen a blue line across a blue, solid blue menu bar, it's because you haven't got a new design. I imagine that everybody has been rolled out the new design by now. It's a couple of weeks old now. So if you've still got the blue band at the top, it's because you haven't been rolled out the new design yet, but it will come to you shortly if you haven't. So a couple of things that I want to draw attention to immediately are at the top there on the right-hand side, you can actually go in and edit your public profile URL. So at the moment, if you haven't done that, by default, it's probably a string of numbers, but you can actually type in your own name. Now, you'll be lucky if you get your own name. I don't think even when I did it years ago, I couldn't get Gordon White. I could get Gordon White 1, I think mine is. But you're better to actually try and personalize your URL in some way. So just click on the edit public URL and try and get a URL that personalizes it a bit for you. Below that, you've got the opportunity to add another language. So if you are dealing overseas, you want your profile to display in the language that the person is, the country, the person viewing it in. So I think I've set mine up for French, German, and Spanish. So that if somebody in Spain is viewing my profile, the information has been displayed in Spanish to them. So it is worth doing that as well. I should have also said that some of the stuff I'm going to share with you today is my advice and some is about how LinkedIn actually works. The next thing is my own advice, and it's my own personal preference, is the header image. I encourage people not to use heavily branded headers. And the reason for that is that when I go to somebody's profile and it's got heavy branding in it or some kind of sales message, it's an immediate turn off. I immediately think this person is going to try and sell me something. This is not your business page. This is your personal profile. There's plenty of opportunities down the page to start introducing your business and what you do. When somebody first hits on your profile, the last thing you want to do is put them off by making them think you're going to try and sell something. So I try and get people to avoid putting heavily branded headers into their profile. As I say, it's not LinkedIn advice, it's just my own personal preference. I liken it to going to a networking event and somebody walking up without an introduction and hands you a brochure and asks for an appointment. There's a process you have to go through in LinkedIn to actually create relationships, which we'll come to. But I don't think the header image is the place to start. So what I have there is just a collage of pictures from the New Media Breakfast event that Bob mentioned earlier.
Gordon, Gordon, can I just ask? I actually work for a charity, Ronald McDonald House in Glasgow. Yeah. And my whole purpose of being on LinkedIn is to raise the profile of my involvement with Ronald McDonald House, and obviously the knock-on effect that has in extending our networks and our opportunities to raise funds and awareness. Yeah. So from that perspective, I mean, I'm on Twitter at a personal capacity, but LinkedIn for me is absolutely my business opportunity.
Yeah.
Does that still go against, well, say go against, does that still say to you yeah. that you would, so for example, our banner headline is we all the team, all the fundraising team have a special Ronald McDonald banner headline.
Yeah. As I say, it's personal preference. I just find it a bit of a turn off when I go to a profile and there's any branding in it. And one of the biggest successes I'm going to share with you that we've ever had on LinkedIn is with a company who had not just branded headers, but also the name of the brand in the photo icon. And my advice was remove it all. And they did remove it all for the reasons that I've just given you. Because this is, they're trying to engage with somebody as you at the moment. There's plenty of opportunity within the LinkedIn profile to actually start introducing what you do. But the prime focus at the moment is to try and to get people to connect and engage with you personally. And as I say, it's not a hard and fast rule. It's just a personal preference. And as I say, the example I'm going to give a bit later on, that company were using heavily branded personal profiles until they removed them all, and they had enormous success in LinkedIn after that. I think it's something you have to decide yourself, and maybe wait until you've seen the other things I'm going to talk about on the personal profile and then make the decision. But as I say, it's not a hard and fast rule. It's just my own advice to people. The next thing is your personal profile picture. The main advice I would give you there is make it something that is current. This is not a dating site. Don't be tempted to put in a picture from, well, in my case, 20 years ago when I had a lot less wrinkles and probably looked a bit better. The last thing that you want to do, because if anything I talk about today is going to work, hopefully it's going to result in face-to-face meetings when we're allowed to have them, and seeing the whites of somebody's eyes and shaking hands and doing a deal. The last thing you want to do when you eventually meet somebody that you've been talking to for 2 months on LinkedIn is put up a barrier because you look nothing like your profile picture. So make the profile picture current. We're not trying to get a date here. We're trying to get build trust. And that's my main advice around the LinkedIn picture. The next thing is that as I go down my profile here, if there's anything missing from your profile, it's probably because you haven't added it yet. So if you just go to the add profile section, and you're able to add different things to your profile. So if you're seeing something in my profile that's not on your own profile, just click in the add profile section and you'll find it in there. You'll see beside my name here, there is a little speaker. That is actually designed for people whose name is difficult to pronounce. So you can record your name so that people know how to pronounce your name. Now, to do this, you need to go into the mobile app, and if you go to the little settings and then a little pencil, you'll get the option to record. It's up to 10 seconds. Don't do what I've seen some people do and try and put a 10-second sales message in there. It's designed for you to say your name so that people know how to pronounce your name. And it just helps people if you've got that. Gordon White is not actually difficult to pronounce, but I've put it in anyway so that people can actually go and listen to it on my profile. The next part down is very, very important. When somebody visits your profile, by default, if I hadn't edited this, it would say Managing Director at FabBuzz. Now, that doesn't really mean anything to anybody. So you want this to say something that would make people want to read a bit more. So tell them what it is you do or how you can actually assist them. And make it something that would make people want to read a bit more about you. And to do that, again, just go into the little pencil and edit what you've written in there. This is one of the areas that the LinkedIn algorithm looks at as well. So try and put in a couple of keywords into that. You've got, I think it's now increased to a 220 character limit in there. So try and put something in there that actually would make people want to find out a wee bit more about you. The next thing down is just about housekeeping. Make sure you put your contact info in. We're doing this to try and make connections. The amount of times I actually want to call somebody or email them, go into their contact info and they haven't completed it. Just make sure you're making it easy for people to contact you by completing all your contact info. The next section down, the about section, again, very important, because this is one of the prime areas that the LinkedIn algorithm gets its information about you from. again, from a user point of view, make sure the first 2.5 lines are compelling enough to make people want to click see more. Because A, because you want them to read it, and B, when you click the see more, you send a signal to the algorithm. If I just scrolled through my profile now without clicking the see more, the algorithm has no idea how much I've actually taken in. But if people click on it, a high percentage of people that come to my profile click the see more, it's actually telling the algorithm this must be quite an interesting profile, because quite a lot of people click the see more to find out more about it. So make sure the first 2.5 lines make people want to find out a bit more about what you see. If we just have a look at what's in my about section there, I think this is still restricted to a 2,000 character limit. So you need to be fairly concise. But the main mistake that I see people making here is, if I had put in here, FatBuzz is a marketing agency based in Glasgow. This is not FatBuzz's profile. This is Gordon White's profile. And it should be about Gordon White, not about the business. By all means, mention the business in here and what you do within the business. But this is, people are on here to find out about me, not about my business. You can, the other tip I would give you here is in this question that I've asked here, what can I do for you? Because people want to find out about me, but essentially they want to find out why they would want to get to know me. And by asking the question, I can then answer it, but I can answer it in a legible sentence that's good for the user, but I've also then been able to put in some keywords and phrases for the algorithm that I want the algorithm to read. So I've been able to put in here, without having to use bullet points, content creation, brand journalism, influence marketing, email marketing, customer service, Facebook advertising, and lead generation. So just by asking the question, what can I do for you, you're able to actually list some of the things you can do. And again, that's very important that the algorithm can read that. The general advice I give people about this about section is, imagine you're at a networking event, somebody asks you, tell me a bit about yourself. That's the kind of information you want to put in here. And as I say, avoid starting with talking about the business, because this is your personal profile at this stage. Going further down the page, the featured section is fairly new. It's been added in the last 4 months. A very good addition, because it allows you to feature content on your personal profile. And you can feature articles you've written. You can feature, one of the good things is you can feature a post. So you've probably been in the situation before where you put up a post and, you know, within a matter of a couple of hours, it's very difficult to find that post. But you actually want to feature it. So if you just click the plus button here, it will give you options of what you can, it'll bring up the articles you've published, it'll bring up posts that you've posted recently, and you can say, right, feature that on my profile page. And it allows you to control some of the content that you can allow other people to see on the page. Great addition to the page. And if you go to my profile today, you'll see different things featured there, because this screenshot was taken a couple of weeks ago. So start to feature the content you really want people to see on your profile page. The next section down is only available to you. So when you're logged in, you'll see that information. Other people won't see it. It's just telling you a bit about how many times your profile's been viewed, post viewed, and people, number of times people have searched. But nobody else can see that. It's only you that can see your own information there. In the activity section, again, fairly new addition within the last year, I would say, but it allows you to see the activity of a person. One of the things that I would recommend is, if you're getting invites to connect with people, just take a minute to actually go to the activity section and click see all, because that will very quickly give you an indication if the person is just going to try and sell you things, because you'll see all of that person's recent activity on LinkedIn. What they've liked, what they've shared, what they've posted, what they've commented on. all comes up within that activity. So it's a good way of, and it's amazing how quickly you tell this person is actually posting good, interesting content, or this person is just trying to sell to people. So take a minute to go in there. The other thing is that you can manage followers from here. And I cover a lot more detail in this in the actual training. But one of the things that I would suggest is that for one reason or another, you may be connected to people. And if you are, by default, you're following them. But you may not necessarily want to see their content appearing in your news feed all the time. So you can actually unfollow connections. And you don't need to worry. They won't be notified that you've unfollowed them. All you're doing is telling the algorithm that you're not really interested in seeing the day-to-day content from that person. Now, the big advantage of doing that, and you, if you try it, you'll be amazed at how much more relevant the newsfeed becomes to you if you start telling the algorithm the stuff you don't want to see. And you, the fastest way to do that is just to unfollow the people whose content you may not want to unconnect with them, you just don't want to see their daily content. So a good exercise, it does make the personal profile, the newsfeed, much more relevant to you if you filter out stuff that you don't need to see every day. The next section then is the experience. And again, the main advice I would give you here is populate your job descriptions, both your current job description and your past job descriptions, because again, it's a major piece of real estate where the algorithm is taking information about you. So make sure you've got full descriptions of your current job and your previous jobs. You'll see also that I've got some video in my job description, and you can add media into your job description. So the first video here is actually just a video of me saying basically the same stuff that's in the about section. And there's quite a lot of people view that because people would rather consume video content, especially on a mobile device, than scroll through screens of text. So if you view that video, you'll see it's just me introducing myself and saying who I am, what I do. It's deliberately shot on an iPhone rather than their broadcast quality cameras we have here. To demonstrate that we're not trying to win a BAFTA here, we're trying to get useful information out to people. And small screen video is perfectly adequate for that. So smartphone video, the one thing that's more likely to let you down with smartphone is the sound quality than the picture quality. And my advice there is if you're recording a piece straight to camera and you don't have an external microphone, use your headset. Because there's a directional microphone on there, and record the audio with the microphone in your earbuds or your headset, and you'll get good enough picture quality and good enough sound quality. The next video along is our current FatBuzz showreel, and the next one along is, if you can get this type of content, it's invaluable, not just for LinkedIn, but this is a video from the brand manager at Dean's. And I could spend 2 hours telling you what we've done for Dean's Shortbread over the last 13, 14 years. But in 3.5 minutes, the brand manager at Dean's tells you what FatBuzz have done for Dean's. And that is extremely powerful content. So, excuse me, if you've got the ability to grab video testimonials, this is a good place to embed them. And you've got the opportunity to add media to your job descriptions, and I would suggest you do it. You can also add PowerPoint presentations via a platform called slideshare.net, which is also owned by LinkedIn. You'll also see, if we just zoom out a wee bit here, I have 4 current jobs listed there. It used to be you could only have 1 current job. Now you can have as many current jobs as you like. So if you are the non-exec director somewhere, or your chairman of something, or I would make sure that you're listing all your current positions. The one that I would draw attention to here is the artist one. Now, this is a hobby. I don't do this for payment at all. And a few people ask me, why do you have that in there? And then the simple reason is that if I look at the last 34 years in business, I would say almost half of the work that we have picked up over the years has come from a non-business connection. So it could be the kids are at the same school. It could be that I met them playing golf. It could be I met them on holiday. Not all business comes from a business connection. So people that are interested in art potentially will connect with me, and they are potential clients as well. Now, I was down in Kent delivering training to a client we have down there, and when I explained this, a lady said, I'm actually treasurer of my local silversmith club. Should I put that on? I said, yeah, by all means, put it on. And about 3 months later, I was in the office in Kent, and I was walking through the main office when the lady came running over to me. She said, this is amazing. She said, this company sell IT, outsourced payroll, and outsourced HR. And she said, we've just signed up a new IT support client who came to us because the guy connected with me because he's into silversmithing. So it does work. So if you've got a hobby or interest, I'd be tempted to put it in there and see if that draws any connections as well. Moving further down, you've got things like education. The licenses and certificates there, this is a course that I did on LinkedIn Learning by a friend of mine, CC Chapman, who wrote a book called Content Rules. I'll just go in and see what he's saying on this training course. Series of five videos. Once you work through the training course in five videos, you get the opportunity to add the badge that you've completed that training course to your profile. So that's what that is. Next one down, volunteer experience. Increasingly, people are influenced by what you give back. And if you are doing stuff for charity or you're involved with a charity, I would encourage you to put it into your profile as well, because it does have an influence on and it says something about you. So I would encourage you, if you are doing any charity work, to actually mention it on your in the volunteer experience part of your profile. The next part down is skills and endorsements. And this is interesting because this is the first time on the profile where it's not me saying something, it's other people endorsing me. Up until now, I could have put anything I like in my profile and there's nothing, nobody's gonna actually stop me doing it. I could say that I'm the chairman of Renfrewshire Chamber of Commerce and there's nobody to stop me. Bob will eventually get upset and complain to LinkedIn, and at some point in the future, LinkedIn will remove it. But I can basically put anything into my profile. This is the first part of your profile that actually gives it credibility. So encourage people to give you endorsements, and the best way to do that is actually to endorse other people. And you'll see here the number of people that have endorsed me for different things. I must admit, I'm more I prefer the recommendations part, which is much the same, but it's a written recommendation rather than just an endorsement. And if you've just finished a piece of work with somebody and it's gone particularly well, just use the tab here, ask for recommendation, type in the person's name, and they'll get a request sent to them for a recommendation. You will get the opportunity to review that recommendation before it's published on your profile, and you can decide whether it's published or not. Little tip here, if you're successful enough in LinkedIn and you have arranged a meeting with somebody that you've connected to in LinkedIn and you want to find out a bit more about them, one of the temptations is to go to the recommendations they've received and find out what they're all about. I would argue that you're far better not to bother with these that they've received, and you're far better to go to the recommendations they've given, because you only need to read two or three of the ones I've given to find out what's important to me. So I'll talk about things like professionalism, integrity, exceeding expectations, things like that. And immediately, and you'll see that it's consistent on all the recommendations I've given. So obviously these things are important to me if these are things I like in other people. You'll also get a much better indication of the type of language I use by reading the ones I've been given, because the ones I've given are all written by me. The 17 that I've received are all written by different people with different values and different things impress them. So if you want to try and find out a bit more about somebody, focus more on the recommendations they've given other people and you'll find out what's important to them. Down at the bottom here is the interest section, and that's where you'll find out all the other things about people. So the groups have joined, the influencers have followed, the business pages they follow. The only bit of advice I would give you here is if you are dealing with a company, if you've got a client who has a business page, follow the business page. Show them that you're taking an interest in their business by following the business page that they have. And then right down at the bottom, there is a tab here, manage your account privacy. Again, I advise people to go in there and just check that you're happy with the privacy settings. It's not so bad since the Cambridge Analytica scandal, but by default, any social media platform is going to have your profile as open as it possibly can. So just take the time to go in there and check that you're happy with the default settings for your privacy, and you've got the option to change any of these when you're in there. So that's everything about the personal profile. Is there any questions at all at the moment about
Gordon, can I just quickly ask, when it comes to actually giving recommendations, does the LinkedIn algorithm pick up in your words or your texts you've actually given?
Once it's published, yes, it will. Yeah. Anything is published. As I say, when you ask for a recommendation, is a private message between you and the individual until you actually decide to publish it. Okay. Then the algorithm will pick it up.
And a question from Phil. Phil, do you want to come in?
Hi, sorry. The one question I have is, and I would think this potentially depends on who you are, what your role is within your company. Does anybody else get constant spam on LinkedIn with people just contacting them, trying to sell them services or random invitations?
Yeah.
Is there a way to minimise that per se?
I think the more active you are and the more you've told the algorithm, the more it is going to filter these out. But I would say since the start of COVID, there has been a massive increase in both the invitations to connect and the amount of message ads that you're seeing, which are probably what you're talking about in terms of spam. So you're probably getting, if you're anything like me, you're getting lots of information about AMD tax credits and all that kind of stuff. These are message ads that are being targeted at you because of a profile. And everybody's will be different in terms of what they're receiving, depending on what people are targeting. But I think it's just symptomatic of the increase in activity on LinkedIn at the moment. You're seeing a lot more of it. Yeah. Does that answer the question, Phil? Or?
No, I was meaning messages. I know about the targeted ads on the pages. I'm more, how do you, is there a way to be able to filter incoming communications through messages? So, for instance, I run a website for a company. I get tons of messages with people just trying to sell me. And I mean direct messages, not just on the ads feed. And on your sort of news wall, as it would be, it's more direct communications. Is there a way to limit that at all?
Are these people
without closing all communications?
Are these people? Are you connected with these people?
I would generally say no. It's people that I'm not connected
yeah,
with.
Yeah, I think you actually have the setting on which allows people to connect you without actually being connected, so they can send you private messages. So you need to set up in privacy, I believe. I've heard about it a couple of days ago myself, that you know, you can get DMs.
Yeah, again, it goes back to just checking that you are happy with the settings you've got and who can message you, who can connect with you and all the rest of it. But I think you will be able to control it. You can block people as well completely. They won't be notified that you've blocked them, but they'll probably know because you'll just disappear from LinkedIn completely in their eyes. But I think if you check your privacy settings, but there's certainly a lot more messaging activity at the moment because there's a lot more usage at the moment. But again, if it's coming from connections, I would suggest you unfollow the connection as well, to tell the algorithm that you don't really want to see this content. Yeah. And you can report activity as well if you want, if it's becoming a real nuisance. So I hope that helps some way. Yeah. Any other questions at all before we...
I had a question, Gordon, just relating to kind of Phil's point. So it might be a silly question, but when you unfollow someone and you therefore reduce the sort of stream of posts from them, is the only option or recourse for them to be directly in touch with you then a private message? And therefore, do they know at that point that you've unfollowed them? You know, because you seem to imply earlier that they wouldn't know that you've unfollowed them.
If you unfollow a connection, they won't be notified, no.
Okay.
The only notification would be if you blocked someone, it changes the way that the message structure is, so that they could quite easily see that you've been blocked, but not unfollowed.
Okay. Right, so there's a kind of fine line there, isn't there, between who you want sort of communications with regularly
I've never actually blocked anybody. I find that if you just unfollow them, it's sufficient. The reverse is not true though. If you follow somebody, they will be notified that you're following them. But if you unfollow somebody, they won't be notified. So, yeah. Does that help at all? Okay. The next part I want to cover is actually measuring your performance on LinkedIn. And it's everybody has the ability to see how well they're doing on LinkedIn, and say it's about social selling, and that's what LinkedIn is all about. And it gives you a score out of 100 based on how well you're actually using LinkedIn. And that score out of 100 is calculated with using four things. So have you established your personal brand? So that's largely to do with the things we've just been through on your personal profile and how complete is the information in terms of your personal details on LinkedIn. And it will give you a score out of 25 for that. And according to what it knows from your personal information, are you finding the right people? So is the information in your personal brand and the people you're connecting with in alignment? And I'll give you a score of 25 for that. Are you engaging with insights? So essentially that just means, are you liking, commenting and sharing and publishing content? And how much of that are you doing? And you'll get a score of 25 for that. And the people that you are connecting with, are you continuing to build a relationship with these people? And that will score you at 25. So these four things, 25 for each, gives you your score out of 100. So this is my current score, and this is as of last night. It changes, I think it's weekly now, it changes. And it's worth keeping an eye on it because it tells you how well you're doing on LinkedIn. And you can't cheat these scores. So it's a great indication of where you can improve your performance on LinkedIn. So you'll see Is giving me 22.5 out of 25 for my personal information. If you just click on a little question mark there, it will bring up a description of how it comes to that, what that score means. It's given me 14.89 out of 25 for am I finding the right people. It's given me 12.43 out of engaging with insights, and I don't do enough commenting, liking. I do a lot for other people, but not enough for myself. So there I can see right away where I can improve. The bottom one sits at 25 out of 25 all the time, and there's a reason for that that I'll come back to. So my current score is 75. Now, I mentioned earlier about the company with which we've had an enormous amount of success, and this is a global window manufacturer who in the UK, when we started working with them 3 years ago, were turning over 25 million. And they brought us in to talk to them about, to their commercial sales team, about how they could open doors with the big regeneration projects, primarily in London and Birmingham. Because their windows, whilst they're exceedingly expensive, are ideal for social housing projects. And it's the big money has been spent in London and Birmingham. They wanted to get into there. And they wanted to identify how the sales guys could actually connect with architects, surveyors, and specifiers for these big projects. And we did the LinkedIn training with them. And when the chief saw this page, he then decided to initiate a competition. So every month the sales team meet, there's 26 of them. And every month they meet, and they have to print this page from LinkedIn the day before the sales meeting, and they pin it on the wall in the sales office along with their sales figures. And the person with the highest SSI score actually gets 500 quid cash. And the guy says that, the chief executive says that this is the best 500 quid he spends a month, because it taps into the competitive nature of the sales force, and they can't cheat it. They have to be spending their time on LinkedIn doing the right things. Now, the company has gone from 25 million turnover to 35 million turnover to 44 million turnover last year. And believe it or not, we're on target to do 70 million this year. And the chief executives will quite happily admit that it's largely down to the success of getting into these big regeneration projects, where they're winning contracts at between 5 and 15 million quid now, because they've actually managed to get their sales guys in front of the right people. And he largely puts that down to the activity and the good use of their time on LinkedIn to be able to do that. And I, as I say, in my training course, I cover a lot more about this, but it is one of the big successes, and it's that's not coming from me, it's coming from the chief executive of the company. That this actually works for them in a major way. If you want to check your own SSI score, if you go to linkedin.com/sales/SSI, it will give you your current score. But what you should focus on is where can you improve, and where are you weaker on your use of LinkedIn. And the higher you can get your score, the more effectively you're using LinkedIn for yourself. And basically, it revolves around social selling, which is about not selling to people when you first meet them. It's about attracting people towards you, having conversations with them, and then starting to sell to them. And that's the principles of social selling. And that's the very same way that LinkedIn operates. Any questions at all about that?
Out of interest, obviously commenting on a post is public, which counts towards your SSI. If you're building up your network and therefore your relationship with people one-to-one and your messaging, does the algorithm understand that your messaging, and does messaging count
Yeah, that would come under building relationships. Right. You're actually communicating with them. And so, the algorithm will pick up all of your activity. And are you having an ongoing dialogue with the people you're connected with would be the bottom one there, building relationships. Yeah. Okay. No other questions on that at all? The final thing I want to cover here is going back to the story about Aberdeen and why that activity was important to me in terms of trying to identify somebody I could meet. And it all goes down to what you do when you actually make a connection with somebody. And it's really important. So after I had reduced that search to 171 people, what I did was I just visited and I scrolled through it. There was one or two people I didn't actually visit the profile because I didn't think they were relevant. But I scrolled through the 171 results and anybody I thought that would be interesting to meet, I just clicked on the profile for a split second and then off again. Didn't do anything, didn't message them, nothing apart from just visit profile on the way again. And you're probably wondering, what's the purpose in that? Well, the purpose is you're tapping into people's basic nosiness. On average, 25% of the people that you visit their profile will click on your profile to see who you are. And that's what happened with, and I didn't actually count it at the time, but say it was 160 people whose profile I clicked on for a split second away again, 40 of these will click my profile to find out who I am. And if they see a well-optimized profile and think, that's interesting, I'll invite them to connect with me. And on that occasion, I know the figure was 11 people invited me to connect from the amount of the 100 and odd profiles I visited. And that's about average. So it's 25% of the profiles you visit and about 10% of them will actually ask you to connect with them. So what you do next is really, really important. I should say, though, there are automated tools to do this. There's tools like DuckSoup and Autopilot and things like that. My advice is you do not use these. LinkedIn is clamped down on the use of these plugins and external tools. Ever since the things like the Cambridge Analytica and data scraping, which is what it's called. So my advice in general is do not use automation tools in connection with the use of LinkedIn. I know of two people who have been kicked off LinkedIn for using DuckSoup. So my advice is don't be tempted to use these. These tools will allow you to visit up to, I think it's 900 profiles a day. And it all sounds great, but LinkedIn can detect if you're using them, and if they think you're using them, they will either suspend you or chuck you off LinkedIn. So don't be tempted to use automation tools. Going back to this invitations to connect that I got from 11 people, I'll tell you in a sec what we did with these. But as a general rule, I don't ever invite anybody to connect with me. I encourage them to invite me to connect with them. And there's a couple of ways you can do that. And I was telling this to a client, Stoke and Trent, and he said, how do you do that? As a little experiment, I actually had a bet with him. And he said, the office next door to you, do you know who occupies that? He says, yeah, it's a potteries company. And I said, do you know the chief executive? He said, yeah, I know him well. And I said, right, okay, what's his name? And he told me his name. And I said, right, okay, I'll wager you £5 that within a month I can get that guy to invite me to connect with him without me contacting. And I actually won the fiver in less than a week. And all I did was actually just follow him okay, without connecting to him. And he would have been notified that I was following him, but that's fine. And then when I'm following him, his posts and his activity starts to appear in my newsfeed. And all I do is start to like and comment on it and take an interest in the content that he's publishing. And at some point then he has clicked on my profile, seen what I like, sees, likes what he sees and invites me to connect with him. And I've done that frequently, where I just take an interest in somebody's content, and eventually if your name appears in their posts as somebody who's liked or commented or shared it, sooner or later they're going to click on my profile to see who I am. And that's generally how I would attract people towards me. So in my use of LinkedIn generally is when people invite me to connect with them. And as I say, LinkedIn is about connecting and engaging with relevant people, not lots of people. So I'm not into connecting with lots and lots of people. Now, I have far too many connections at the moment, and it's because of the New Media Breakfast, because somebody attends the breakfast. They'll message me afterwards and invite me to connect, and I feel I can't be impolite and not connect with them. A lot of them I will connect with and then unfollow them because I don't mind being connected to them, but I don't want to see the news in their newsfeed. So be particular about who you connect with. It's not about big numbers. Is the person relevant to you personally or for your business? And if so, connect with them. Have a look at their activities, see if they're likely to be trying to sell to you, or are they actually posting interesting, relevant content that's useful to you. If you connect with somebody, it's important then to engage with them. And if you do nothing when you connect with somebody, nothing is what's going to happen. So when I get an invitation to connect with somebody and I decide to accept that connection, the first thing I do is send a message to them. And it's really, really important to send that message. And that's why the bottom score of 25 never changes in my SSI score. And it's basically because I'm engaging people in conversation and I'm building an ongoing relationship with them. So here is the message that I send out to people when I connect with them. And I just keep this as a draft in my email and just copy and paste it and put the guy's name at the top of it. The first paragraph says, "Thank you for inviting me to connect with you. I look forward to your posts and updates in the future. Please take a minute to look at my connections, and if there's anybody I can introduce you to, let me know and I'll do what I can. Now, I'm not selling anything, I'm offering them introductions." And in the 4 years I've been doing this, I've never once been asked to introduce somebody to my connections. But the sentiment is there. I'm doing the opposite of trying to sell them something. I'm actually offering them something. The next two paragraphs are a bit more salesy, so take a minute to visit my website. And the second paragraph there is about, the third paragraph is about the New Media Breakfast. It's currently suspended anyway because of COVID. The last paragraph is the really, really important one. "Finally, if there's anything I can help you with, please drop me a message and we can perhaps grab a coffee and have a chat." Now, it's not arrange a meeting, it's not get an appointment in the diary, it's grab a coffee and have a chat. And it's really important language. So when I had the 11 invites to connect from the people in Aberdeen, I sent this message out. And what results from this message is usually a message coming back to me saying, "Thanks for your message, I'll take a look at your website," or "the breakfast sounded interesting, thanks for your offer," all these kind of things. And more often than not, they'll refer back to the coffee and say, "Yeah, it'd be good to grab a coffee." Now, one of the people in Aberdeen, when I sent the message, came back and said, "Yeah, that would be great. Let me know the next time you're in Aberdeen and we can grab that coffee." And I was able to go back to him and say, "Well, actually, it so happens I've got 2 hours to kill in 2 weeks' time. Are you around?" The person was around. It was a managing partner of a legal firm. I had the coffee with them. He ended up asking us to quote for some work, which we subsequently did. So I've generated a meeting and generated some income from that original advanced search. And that's how we've used it in the past. And I've done the same. I did the same when I had an afternoon to kill in Nottingham. I've done the same when I've got time to kill in Kent. It genuinely does work, but you need to put a wee bit of effort into it to make it work. But it genuinely does work. So just to finish up, here are a couple of the a few of the responses I get back from this message. I've highlighted the word coffee just to show you how often people refer to the word coffee within the responses you get back. And it's really important to keep it that informal. I've zoomed in on a couple here that are particularly good. Thank you, Gordon. I think this has to be one of the most obliging LinkedIn connection responses I've ever received. This one here, thanks, Gordon. I love that message so much that I might plagiarize it. And please feel free to plagiarize it in any way you want. And the one that I got just the other day, you definitely win the internet for that response, Gordon. I think you've done this before. If you don't mind, I might pinch a bit of it. So you can see I'm immediately entering into a conversation with these people because I'm sending a message back that is not selling them anything. It's actually offering them something. They're coming back to me with a message and the algorithm is seeing that I'm starting to engage with my new connections. And I can then drive it from there. If I've made that offer of a coffee to somebody and I think actually they've accepted that and they just want to try and sell me something, I can control whether I have that coffee or not, but I'm in the conversation then. If I had done nothing and just accept a request from them, nothing is going to happen. But by actually sending back the message, you start to control the relationship. I hope all that makes sense. I'm happy to answer any questions at all. Just before I do, I'll just show you the next session I'm doing next Thursday is much more about the business and how the business can use LinkedIn. So we're looking at posting to LinkedIn, best practice, how to extend the reach of your content, LinkedIn articles, business pages, LinkedIn advertising, LinkedIn groups, and very importantly, how to make use proper use of hashtags and so on. So these are some of the topics I'll be covering next week. So happy to answer any questions at all anybody has.
Thank you, Gordon. That was really first class, and I know we are over time, but great to see we haven't lost anybody. So that's a good sign, and I think that just shows mm-hmm. there's some really, really kind of fantastic examples there. I suppose just a very quick question again. You know, coming back to that idea of kind of paid advertising in LinkedIn. I mean, do you feel that making that small investment in a premium account is probably the best thing you can do on LinkedIn if you want to use it to its fullest extent as a sales and marketing tool?
Yeah, I mean, you can use LinkedIn advertising on a free account. You need to have a business page to actually have an ad manager account on LinkedIn, but you don't need to have a paid account to use it. And it does work very, very well. The premium account, the benefits there are the amount of search you can do, and you can actually see who's viewed your profile in the last 90 days, unlimited amount of people who have viewed your profile in the last 90 days. You get access to LinkedIn Learning, and I think you get a bit more in mail messaging as well that you can utilize. It really is up to you. And as I say, if you're thinking about the premium account, take the 30-day free trial and see how much of the other functionality you're using before you commit to it.
Can I just come in on the back of that? Because you talked about this really interesting chain of events, obviously from your Aberdeen experience. Yeah. And you talked about, you went on to these connections for a split second, and the way you talk, it sounds like I mean, the guys that you were clicking on wouldn't have known it was you, Gordon White from Fat Buzz, if you have premium.
Sorry? So, right?
What I'm saying is the guys that you clicked on to look at, they wouldn't have known that you looked at them if you have a premium account.
No, the premium account's got nothing to do with it. You can, within your privacy settings, you can actually view, profiles anonymously if you want, but my advice is, why would you do that? Why wouldn't you want people to, why would you want to be anonymous on a networking platform? You can switch, I think what you're referring to is that as a premium user, I can view other people's profiles and they can't see me.
Correct, is that right?
Yeah, but anybody can do that. Free.
So you don't need a premium account to look at posts anonymously.
No, you can go into your privacy settings and change that. But yeah, why would you want to view? I know why you would want to. I get clients phoning me up and ask me to view ex-employees' profiles anonymously so that they can get a screenshot of them and stuff like that. But generally, if you're using it as a networking platform, why wouldn't you want people to see you? The other mistake that I do see people making in the privacy is that they don't realize that their profile picture is not shown, is only shown to connections. You should set it so that your profile picture is shown to everybody. And if you're going to use it as a genuine networking platform, have your settings, these settings, as open as possible. And my whole intention of visiting other people's profiles is so that they can see or visit them.
Gordon, can I ask, in terms of the future of LinkedIn, you know, if you think of how the platform has evolved and grown since March of this year, and in particular through the lens of COVID, what do you see in the next 6 to 12 months in your experience in terms of how the developer, where the emphasis will continue to be?
Well, next Thursday I will be explaining why I believe that pages will be a lot more important, business pages. And indeed, it's the most underused function on LinkedIn at the moment, the things you can do with a business page, and the new functionality that's been added to business pages since the start of COVID are enormous. So I think that they're trying to change the focus away from, not away from everything happening on a personal profile, but they want to make it much more of a corporate environment as well, with much more, there's already a lot more appearing in your newsfeed published from business pages. There's also a very strong rumor there's a blog about to be added to business pages. Things like events were added to everybody's business page at the start of COVID to help people host online events and so on. And there's been a few changes around that since then as well. But the growth is surprising, actually, because it last year at 655 million, it gradually crept up to that, but it's jumped enormously since then in the last year to 722, I think it is now.
Okay, great.
Thanks, guys. I need to go. Thanks very much for that.
No bother.
Thanks, Gordon. Thanks, Bob.
Thank you, Cosy.
Can I just ask one thing, please?
Yes, jump in, please.
Sorry. Yeah. excuse me. I don't use it enough. Hopefully stuff like this has been very useful. We'll see me use it more in future. When I do, I generally do it on the mobile app. Am I better doing it online? Is there anything you can't do on the mobile app that you can do on the website?
No, you can pretty much do the same things. It's down to personal preference. The one thing that the mobile app does have, and it's a very recent addition that the desktop doesn't, is LinkedIn Stories, which is similar to Facebook Stories and Instagram Stories. It's just been introduced. I'm not a big user of Stories on any platform, but I prefer desktop because I'm more often at a desktop and my fingers are far too fat for typing things.
I have that problem as well.
Mobile. It's down to personal preference. I mean, pretty much seamless transition from one to the other now. You do the same things apart from stories, I think, on both.
Thank you.
Any other questions at all?
Okay, everybody. Gordon, thank you very much. That was... Sorry, somebody else want to come in there? Sorry, thank you. That was excellent, Gordon. Thank you, and a fantastic segue into next week. So if you've enjoyed the session today, and I know a number of you booked on for next week, but recommend yourselves or your colleagues, you know, the more the merrier. And we look forward to the second instalment of Gordon's fascinating journey. And let's just finish on a comment from Tess here in the chat. She says, thanks so much, Gordon. Myth busting brilliance. So there you go. That's maybe the latest comment you can maybe post on your LinkedIn page. So thank you, Tess. And thank you, everybody, for joining us. I will circulate the link for the slides and also the recording as well, Gordon, if that's okay. We have recorded it. So just to make sure you're okay with that, I'll pop that onto the Chamber YouTube page as well, and we'll pop that over to you. So hope you have an enjoyable rest of the week. And Gordon, thank you. And we'll look forward to catching up with you next week. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.